Romans chapter 10, that's where we're at tonight. Romans chapter 10. Last week we finished Romans chapter 9, and we saw that throughout the entire chapter, Paul was showing us that God does in fact sovereignly choose. And the examples that Paul used to show us that were the examples of Isaac and Ishmael, Jacob and Esau, and even Pharaoh. Now, one may wonder, is there unrighteousness with God? That was the question that Paul had anticipated. And so Paul says, certainly not. And then that's when we see Paul take them in their own history back to the story of Pharaoh. When Moses received the Ten Commandments, he had returned to find the Israelites worshiping an idol, a golden calf. And God was going to wipe them off the face of the planet. But Moses interceded on behalf of the people. And God withheld his hand of judgment. God showed mercy upon the people of Israel, even though they deserved to be judged. But when it came to Pharaoh, well, God judged Pharaoh. Neither group deserved mercy from God. Both deserved his judgment. And so God will have mercy on whom he wills and harden whom he wills. To further explain God's mercy and grace, Paul quotes the prophet Isaiah and he says, "And as Isaiah said before, unless the Lord of the Sabbath had left us a seed, we would have become like Sodom and we would have been made like Gomorrah." And so it is true. The Bible teaches election. The Bible teaches predestination. The Bible teaches that God sovereignly chooses. He has mercy on some and on others he hardens the hearts. And some people may have a real problem with that. But Paul gives everyone a reality check by saying, "Indeed, O man, who are you to reply against God? Will the thing formed say to him who formed it, 'Why have you made me this way?' Does the potter not have power over the clay? From the same lump to make one vessel for honor and another for dishonor?" And that's a great reminder for us, because there will be times in our lives where we wonder why God did this, or why God did that, or why didn't God do this, or why didn't God do that? And we just have to stop and remind ourselves, hey, wait a second, we're not the potter, he is. We're the clay. Who are we to question him on how he does things? And so that's where we left off. Now, I told you I would have two new words of the week, since I didn't have one last week. I'm a man of my word. So here they are. First is the word contumacious. Contumacious. Here's the definition. It means to be stubbornly perverse or rebellious, willfully and obstinately disobedient. Second word of the week is uncouth. You guys know that one? GD, guys, I told you. All right, whatever. So here's the definition. You can correct me if I'm wrong. Uncouth is to be lacking good manners, refinement, or grace. So keep an eye out, ear out for those in tonight's message. But let's get into it, guys. Romans chapter 10, verse 1. Paul says this. He says, "Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they may be saved. For I bear them witness that they have zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted to the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes." Now, something that I think we can get mixed up when it comes to Israel and the Jews of Paul's day is that we read of things like their idolatry, right? We read of their rejection of Christ and crucifying him. And we can kind of get this idea that, you know, these were kind of like anti-God people. Or that they just didn't really care that much about God. But that definition more describes our nation today than it does Israel. Because the fact of the matter is that Israel had great zeal for God. Paul says, I bear them witness. I vouch for them. I was one of them. And I'm telling you right now that Israel has great zeal for God. And that's a good thing. There's nothing wrong with zeal for God. But Paul explains that although they were zealous for God, their zeal was not according to knowledge. In other words, their zeal was misdirected, you could say. The Jews' zeal and sincerity they had for God would not lead them into salvation. As a matter of fact, it says right there in verse 3, they were ignorant of God's righteousness. What does Paul mean by that? Well, God's righteousness is the Lord Jesus Christ. Righteousness comes through faith in Jesus Christ. That's the only way to be declared righteous before God. And so Paul's saying they have zeal for God, but not according to knowledge, because they are ignorant to the fact that God's righteousness comes through faith in Jesus, the Messiah. Instead, Paul says they're seeking to establish their own righteousness and have not submitted to the righteousness of God. How are they trying to establish their own righteousness? Well, by keeping the Mosaic Law. Okay, and when we talk about the Mosaic Law, for you brand new Christians who don't know, it's the law that God gave Moses, contained the commandments for Israel. So they're trying to keep the law. Establish their own righteousness. They're depending on their own works for salvation. And as long as one is trying to earn salvation through works, then they are not submitted to the righteousness of God, which again is salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. We're saved by God's grace through faith in Jesus, and that not of ourselves. It is a gift of God. Not of works, not of law keeping, not of being a good person. Okay? Lest any man should boast. And so in verse 3 right there, we're told that they are ignorant of God's righteousness, they are seeking to establish their own righteousness, and they are not submitted to the righteousness of God. Now, Paul's talking about the Jews here. But let me ask, how many of you know someone that fits that description? They're ignorant of how to get to heaven. They believe if they're a good enough person, they'll make it through the pearly gates. Seeking to establish their own righteousness. They believe that all roads lead to heaven, not submitted to the righteousness of God, that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one goes to the Father except by Him. Not submitted to that. I mean, we all know people like that. They believe in a higher power, or believe in God but not Jesus. Perhaps they're completely contumacious when it comes to faith in Christ. And that's a bummer, isn't it? Because we have family members like that. I do. We have friends like that. We have coworkers and neighbors. We have people that we love. They are good people, but they fall into that description. And we know the truth, but they are stubborn and ignorant to the righteousness of God. So what do we do? Glance back at verse 1. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they may be saved. I love that. Because we see that just because someone is ignorant, unwilling to submit, and believing what they want to believe, it doesn't mean that there's no hope for them. No one's too far gone to be saved by Jesus. Paul says, yeah, Israel is all of those things. They have a misdirected zeal, zeal not according to knowledge. They're ignorant of God's righteousness. They're not submitted to Christ, but I'm not giving up on them. I pray to God for them that they might be saved. And so the very first verse of this chapter is such an encouragement to every one of us who have unsaved friends, unsaved family members, neighbors, coworkers, people we love. It encourages us to be like Paul, praying without ceasing that they might be saved. Prayer is the most powerful thing we can do for them and for our nation. Let's keep going. Verse 4. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. For Moses writes about the righteousness which is of the law. The man who does those things shall live by them. What Paul's saying here is that when it came to the Jews, they would work so hard at trying to keep the law. Remember, they were zealous. But what they didn't understand, and many still don't today, is that Christ freely gives to those who believe in him the very thing they were trying to obtain by keeping the law. And so for those who believe in Jesus, Christ is the end to that. Christ is the end to trying to earn your way to heaven. Christ is the end of works for salvation, trying to keep the law. And what an awesome thing. What a blessing that we have. Because I don't know about you, but I'm not a perfect man by any means. I can be uncouth at times. I'm a sinner, guys. You know, I'm a sinner, and saved by God's grace. And on my own, I would be in real trouble. Because righteousness is the requirement for eternal life. And there's nothing righteous about me. And whether you realize it or not, there's nothing righteous about you. Or you at home watching. That's what Paul tells us in Romans 3, verse 10. As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. But you know who is righteous? Jesus. And when a man or a woman places their faith in Jesus as their Lord and Savior, he cleanses them from all unrighteousness and he cloaks them in his righteousness because they are now in Christ. That is what the Israelites that Paul loved and prayed for didn't get. and their attempt to keep the law was futile. Even Moses said concerning the law, the man who does those things shall live by them. In other words, the man or the woman who depends on keeping the law must keep every single bit of it to a T for their entire life. Live by them. It's not, oh, I kept this one, check it off. Oh, I kept that, check it off. No, continually live by them. And if you stumble at one point, you give in to temptation one time, you sin in any way, and it's very easy to sin, then that's it. You're guilty of breaking every single command in the law. That's what James tells us. You stumble at one part, you're guilty of breaking it all. And the consequences of that is death, eternal death. And so there's the righteousness of the law, which no man can keep. Or there's what Paul says in verse 6, the righteousness of faith. Okay, so take a look with me at verse 6. He says, but the righteousness of faith speaks in this way. So he's contrasting now. He says, this is what the righteousness of the law is. Now this is the righteousness of faith. It speaks in this way. Do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven? That is to bring Christ down from above. Or who will descend into the abyss? That is to bring Christ up from the dead. Now, that's some difficult verses. What Paul's doing here is he's quoting Moses out of Deuteronomy. He's actually using the law to show them this. But the idea here is that you don't need to ascend up into heaven to find Christ and bring him down to help you. And you don't need to descend among the dead to bring Christ back to life again. It's much easier than that. The righteousness of faith says God already sent Jesus down from heaven. And God already resurrected him from the dead. In other words, he is not far away. He is not afar off. Salvation is not far away. Because verse 8 says, but what does it say? The word is near you. The word is near you. It's in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. The word is near you. The word of faith, it's in your hands right now. It's in your mouth, it's in your heart. And that word of faith says, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and you believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. You don't need to ascend to heaven and bring Christ down. You don't need to go to the depths and resurrect Christ from the dead. Salvation is near you. It's right there. The gospel message is near you. The good news of Jesus Christ is near you. And man makes it so difficult. Whether it be the Jews trying to keep 600 plus rules and regulations, or the Jehovah Witnesses going door to door and bugging you and waking you up, and the Seventh-day Adventists that only goes to, you know, tries to keep the Sabbath and doesn't eat meat. You know, the Catholics, right? Praying the rosary and all this stuff. All these works, traditions, works. But what does it say? That's the question Paul asks. What does the word of God say? If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and you believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you will be saved period. I don't have to go knock on your door, give you my little brochure, you know. I don't have to abstain from certain foods. I don't have to do all that stuff. Confess with your mouth, believe in your heart, you will be saved. That's what it says. And so, you know, does this mean that I just have to say out loud, hey, I believe in Jesus and I'm saved? No, that's not what Paul's getting at. See, true confession that Jesus is Lord is outward evidence of inward faith. Okay? In other words, the confessing the Lord with your mouth is a byproduct of believing that Christ raised him, or that God raised Christ from the dead. Okay, if you believe that, you're going to say Jesus is Lord. And so, believe in the resurrection and confess Jesus with my mouth and I'm saved? Almost. Because it's more than just believing in the resurrection. Paul's not suggesting that justification comes by simply believing in that one event. Okay? The resurrection is a part of it, a huge part of it, but there's more to it. For example, the fact that Jesus is God incarnate and that he willingly went to the cross and died in our place and paid the penalty for our sins. If you do not know and believe that, then simply believing in the single event of Jesus' resurrection, if you don't believe he's God, you don't believe he died for your sins. I mean, so the gospel message is more than just some historical guy named Jesus getting resurrected from the dead, and then you believe that and say it and you're saved. It's more than that. It is the Son of God who came here in the flesh, lived a sinless life, willingly went to the cross, shed his blood and died for my sins and died for your sins. He was buried, and on the third day, God raised him from the dead. And verse 11 says, for the scripture says, whoever believes on him, Jesus, will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon him. For whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Notice, Paul doesn't say whoever believes on the resurrection will not be put to shame. He says, whomever believes on him, Jesus, will not be put to shame. Okay? And believing on Jesus means believing in his deity, his sacrifice on the cross for sin, and his resurrection from the dead. That's it. No works, no earning your way, no keeping the law. We're saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. And it doesn't matter if you're Jew or Greek. In modern times, it doesn't matter if you're black, white, Mexican, big, tall, your culture, your background, where you're from, it doesn't matter. If a Jew calls upon the name of the Lord, God's not going to say, tough luck, you didn't keep the law. I gave you guys law, you didn't keep it. If a Gentile calls upon the Lord, God's not going to say, hey, tough luck, you're a Gentile. And if a Jew or Gentile calls on the Lord, God's not going to say, tough luck, I didn't choose you. For whoever, the Bible says, Jew or Gentile, calls on the name of the Lord, Jesus shall be saved. And so interesting, isn't it? We see God chooses. We saw that last week. And here we see man's responsibility to call on the name of the Lord, to believe on the Lord, and whoever does that will be saved. That's why at Calvary Chapel, Hemet, and real Calvary Chapels, we shoot right up the middle on that, because the Bible does teach both. Okay. For God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. Take a look at verse 14 with me. We start bringing it in for a landing. He says, how then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace, who bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our report? So then, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. But I say they have not heard. Yes, indeed. Their sounds has gone out to all the earth, and their words to the ends of the world. But I say, did Israel not know? First, Moses says, I will provoke you to jealousy by those who are not a nation. I will move you to anger by a foolish nation. But Isaiah is very bold and says, I was found by those who did not seek me, the Gentiles. I was made manifest to those who did not ask for me, the Gentiles. But to Israel, he says, all day long I have stretched out my hands to a disobedient and contrary people. Paul wraps up this chapter by quoting Moses and the prophet Isaiah. But I would like to close tonight by focusing in on the verses just before that. Perhaps next week we'll come back and go more into 18 through 21. But I want to look at verses 14 through 17, because Paul had just told us that whoever calls on the name of Jesus will be saved. But then he asks, but how can they call on Jesus if they don't believe in Jesus? And how can they believe in Jesus if they haven't heard of Jesus? And how can they hear of Jesus if there's no preacher to tell them about Jesus? And how can one preach Jesus if they haven't been sent by God? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. The point that Paul's making is this, and it's not just for Israel and the Jews, it's for the entire world, that the only way for a man or woman to be saved is to put their faith in Jesus Christ. And although most of the world's population has heard of the name Jesus, they don't believe in Jesus. And they don't believe in Jesus because they have not heard. Sure, they've heard his name. They've heard his name. But have they heard of his love for them? Have they heard of his sacrifice on the cross for them? That he died so they can be forgiven of their sins and spend eternity in heaven with them? Have they heard that they're not too far gone for Christ? The idea that every human being on the face of this planet has heard the true gospel message of Jesus is not an accurate statement. You can walk up to someone in this city and ask them, hey, can you tell me the gospel of Jesus Christ? Some can, but I bet the majority of you go, yeah, he was some dude that got crucified, you know? And I believe that a big part of that falls to the fault of the church. Because we can tend to stay in our little church bubble. Or we can say, well, that's the pastor's job, right? I'm not a preacher. That's not what Jesus says. Because if you're a Christian, then you are called by God to be a preacher of Christ. Every single one of you, all of you at home watching, if you're a Christian, you've been called to be a preacher of Christ. And if you're a Christian, then not only have you been called to preach Christ, but you've been sent by God to preach Christ. Sometimes we Christians need to be reminded of the Great Commission. It's in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 28, verses 18 through 20. It says, "And Jesus came and spoke to his disciples, saying, 'All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all the things that I've commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of age. Amen.'" If you are a Christian, then that means you are a disciple of Jesus Christ. And if you're a disciple, then this is your instructions from God Himself. "Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations." You see, the church tends to overlook that part that says go. "Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations." And we can overlook that all nations part too. The problem with staying in the comfort zone of the church bubble, is that you cannot make disciples out of disciples. It's outside the gates. It's outside the gates that people need to hear the gospel message. The church must go, therefore, and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And listen to verse 20. He says, "teaching them to observe all the things that I've commanded you." How can they call on the Lord if they don't believe? How can they believe if they haven't heard? How can they hear if there's no preacher? How can one preach if they're not sent of God? Earlier, Paul spoke about not having to go to heaven and bring Christ down, or go to the depths of hell and bring Christ up, right? Because the word is near. Salvation is near. And I think of all the lost people that we come in contact with every single day. And when we come into contact with them, salvation is so near to them. Because it's in our mouths and it's in our hearts. And how sad when God sends us out and we're near that lost person with that treasure, that gospel message in us, but we don't open our mouth. We keep that treasure we've been given hidden away inside of us, and we only share it when we're in our church bubble around other believers. And so I want to encourage you to remember that each one of you, if you believe in Jesus, you are a Christian, each one of you have been chosen and sent by God. Sent to preach Christ. You do not need to be an ordained pastor. You do not need to stand behind this thing. We're all called to be preachers, called to preach Christ to the lost world outside the gates. And so I want to challenge you, all of you, to share the gospel with at least one person before we meet next Wednesday. One person, that's it. Not send you out on some evangelical rampage. No, just one person. You may get shot down. They may go, get out of here, crazy. Or they may accept Jesus and his gift of eternal life. And so, don't try to cheat and share the gospel with a church member. But be in prayer, okay? Ask God to give you the strength, the courage, and the boldness to share his gospel message in love with at least one person this week. Maybe a lost family member. Maybe a stranger at the store. Maybe a homeless guy on the sidewalk. I don't know. But pray for that. And be praying for that person, even though you don't know who they are. God does. And when you feel the Holy Spirit tugging on your heart, okay, it's just like fishing. You feel that fish tugging on the tip of your pole, set that hook. When you feel the Holy Spirit tugging on your heart saying, this is the one I want you to share the gospel with, set the hook. Follow me, Jesus said, and I'll make you fishers of men. Amen? All right, let's pray. And so, Lord God, that is our prayer tonight. We thank you for our Bible study. We thank you for your word, Lord, the things you've shown us in it. And Lord, we want to fulfill the commission you've given to us to go out into the world, to be those lights, Lord, to preach Jesus. Not to go out and scream it in people's ears and beat people over the head with our Bibles, Lord, and force it on people. That's not how you did it, Jesus. But to just share you with them and your love and what you promise, Lord, that if we believe in you, we're saved. We confess that you're Lord and believe in our heart, we're saved, Lord. The world needs to hear that. They need to know who you really are, Jesus. And so we pray, Lord, that you do give us that boldness, that courage, that strength to share your gospel message. Like Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. For it's the power of God unto salvation. The power of God. And so, Lord, we do ask that you put that person in front of us this week and that you make it clear to us, Lord, through your Holy Spirit, that that's the one, that's the person, Lord, that you want us to strike up a conversation with and tell them about you and who you are, Lord, and what you've done for them. And so we thank you, Lord, we love you, and it's in Jesus' name, amen.